Good morning, everybody. If you would grab your Bible or the Pew Bible in front of you and open up to Proverbs chapter 9. Proverbs chapter 9. As we continue in our Proverbs series, while you're turning there, I'll ask this question. How many of you have seen the Tom Hanks movie Castaway? Most of you, many of you. All right, if you have not seen it, a little bit of a spoiler alert. I'm going to talk about the ending of the movie. And by the way, I don't feel bad because it's been out for 24 years. If you haven't seen it by now. But the ending of Castaway, I was thinking about it this week because it's actually, I think, one of the great endings in cinematic history. There's a character named Chuck, the main character, is played by Tom Hanks. And, you know, the whole movie, he's been in a plane crash and he's been marooned on a desert island for years. And he comes back to life in Memphis, Tennessee, where he's from, to find that everything's changed. His fiance is now married to another man. I mean, he has lost everything. And so at the end of the movie, he's kind of come to terms with that and the fact that his life is about to have to start over. And so he takes a journey, and he finds himself out in the middle of rural Texas. I assume somewhere like in the panhandle of Texas. And the end scene of the movie is he's standing literally in the middle of a crossroads. Two highways that intersect in a perfect cross pattern. And it's West Texas, right? So you've got wide open space. These roads are straight and they're flat. And you can see seemingly forever in every direction. And you just sort of see him look at his options. And I won't completely spoil the movie. But he kind of smirks, like maybe he knows which way he's going to go. But then it just fades to black. And so as audience members, we're left wondering, what does he do? Where does he go? I thought about that this week because as I'm looking at Proverbs chapter 9, Solomon is here describing a similar sort of crossroads moment. He's about to paint a mental picture for his son whom he's writing to. And of course, he's painting the same picture for us as readers of this similar crossroads. In Solomon's scenario, life is sort of like this residential street. And there's houses on both sides of the street. And as his son, he's imagining, sort of walks down this straight path, this street of life, there are two ladies in houses on either side of the street who are calling out. On the one side of the street, we're going to see Lady Wisdom. And as she emerges from her home, she calls out for all who would come and enter in to join her for a feast that nourishes, a feast that satisfies, a feast that gives life. And on the other side of the street, we're going to see Lady Folly. And Lady Folly also beckons all who would pass by her, but the offer to recline at her table and to eat leads to sinful temptation and malnourishment and eventually death. And so the question that Solomon is posing for his son and for us to consider, indeed the question that the Lord is posing for us to consider, is which side will we choose? Which side will we choose? And it's a question that we face all the time. It's a question that we face really on the daily. And it's the question that we face when we are making decisions, and as we'll see, as we make the most important of decisions in our lives. And so we're going to be challenged with this. How do we avoid the pitfall of Lady Folly and choose wisely? So as we begin to examine the text, I want to begin to read these two accounts of these ladies and their houses on either side of the street. And we're going to start with this as our first point, the simultaneous calls of wisdom and folly. Look with me at verse 1 of chapter 9. Wisdom has built her house. She has hewn her seven pillars. She has slaughtered her beasts. She's mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her young women to call from the highest places in the town. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. To him who lacks sense, she says, come, eat of my bread, drink of the wine I have mixed. Leave your simple ways and live, and walk in the way of insight. Look down at verse 13. The woman folly is loud. She is seductive and knows nothing. She sits at the door of her house. She takes a seat on the highest places of the town, calling to those who pass by, who are going straight on their way. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. And to him who lacks sense, she says, stolen water is sweet, and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. But he does not know that the dead are there, that her guests are in the depths of Sheol. So we have these two personifications of wisdom and of folly. One, wisdom is portrayed as this classy and generous benefactor. The other is a loose and dangerous seductress. And we hear them, right? Wisdom and folly both crying out for the attention of the simple person, both offering to give to that person something valuable. But only one of them delivers on her promise. Solomon is describing these two figures along with their homes and their tables and the fate of their guests. And what he's doing is he's presenting them to us really as two opposite mirror images of one another. I want you to notice the house of wisdom. She's built it herself. Right? She's built it with her own diligent hands. And this is a home that conveys strength and stability and prosperity. He describes these seven pillars that she has hewn out with her own hands. These seven pillars are symbolic of wealth. You think about it, ordinary houses don't have pillars. My house doesn't have pillars, right? Mansions have pillars. It's conveying this picture of wealth, of stability, and prosperity. And there's seven of these pillars. And in Scripture, seven is the number of completion, and it's the number of perfection. So we got this image of quite the stately home. We look to the other side of the street, though, and there's no indication there that the house of folly is built with such care and attention. She's not diligent. We're told here she's just loud. She's just loud. She's not stable. She's seductive. Her way is not prosperous. She actually sets a trap. She's not knowledgeable about anything of virtue or value. She's a know-nothing. Looking back to wisdom's home, wisdom sends out her housemaids to gather people to an abundant feast. Folly, on the other hand, sits idly on her porch, sort of enjoying the view like a squatter who's stolen that view from the labors of what others have built. And speaking of this feast that wisdom is calling us to, wisdom has, we're told, slaughtered her beasts. Now, I know that's not a common phrase that we use when we think about preparing dinner. It may sound a little stark, but what it means here is that her table is filled with the choicest of meats. This is a steakhouse dinner that she's calling and inviting people to. She's mixed her wine, we're told here. That doesn't mean that she's watered it down. It means that she's added to it. She's added flavor. She's added spices. She's added things to make that wine more luxurious, more delicious. So we're getting this picture here of a meal that she offers that is a satisfying meal. It's a meal that nourishes and fills the hungry with good things. Folly, on the other hand, only offers cheap bread and water. It's like she's got a bag of Wonder Bread. But even then, it's stolen food. It's flavored with the initial sweetness of temptation, and it provides a temporary rush of dopamine that gives pleasure to those who take pleasure in being sneaky and sinful, but that soon and very quickly only turns to bitterness in the mouth and causes malnourishment. And then Solomon opens the window curtains of each of these homes so that we can sort of glimpse inside to again see the fate of the guests who are in there. Wisdom's guests have left their simple ways behind. Wisdom's guests are enjoying true life and learning to walk in the way of insight. Folly's guests, on the other hand, are dying from her poison. And Solomon makes this really stark picture here. He pictures them as sitting perched on the precipice of hell. So what's Solomon asking us to do? He's saying, which invitation are you going to accept? Which one? Seems like a pretty obvious choice, right? I mean, I read that to you. It's hard to imagine that any of you go, yeah, I want the Wonder Bread and death, please. Right? It seems like a pretty obvious choice. So why do so many of us so often choose to walk into the house of folly? You do, don't you? I do. We do. Why? And why so often? Solomon actually calls us simple people here. And by that, I think he means that we're those who inherently lack the insight needed for living the good life. We inherently lack that insight. And that's true of every single one of us. We're simple people in that regard. But the reason that we're simple, I think, ironically, is this. It's because actually we're quite complicated. Our hearts and our minds are complicated. Our hearts and our minds are not blank canvases on which to sort of create happy little stories with happy little endings like a Bob Ross painting. We're not like that. Our hearts and our minds are messy. And they've always been messy. Your heart and your mind have been messy even since your birth because we all carry Adam's curse. We are all sinners. Romans 5:12. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, that's Adam, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. He's not leaving any of us out. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's why we are so messy. Listen, your free will isn't really as free as you think it is. The effects of sin, again, that all of us are infected with, are so comprehensive that they invade every single part of our being. Jaylin was talking earlier about the impurities of a sword that needs to be refined. Our bodies are like that sword. We are impure because of our sin, but it's not just like the tip is impure or the base is impure or some little part of the middle is impure. We're impure throughout. That's how the Bible describes the nature of our sin problem. Even our will, your will, is corrupted. And that, brothers and sisters, is why you run to the house of folly so naturally. Even when common sense would tell you otherwise. Right? I mean, we just read it, and I said, who wants the Wonder Bread? And nobody raised their hand, right? Common sense would tell us otherwise, but we do it. Our free will bends all the time towards that which our heart most desires. And because our hearts are so corrupted by sin, we desire and we choose folly all the time. And it's not as easy as we think to just choose wisdom. You actually can't do it in your own power. You can't do it in your own power. You need Lady Wisdom to call out to you. Now, here's the good news. She does. She does. In fact, she's doing it even right now. And that invitation is open to all who would hear her call and turn towards her and enter in. Get this, this is really important. Wisdom is not first and foremost a choice that you make. Wisdom is first and foremost a person whom we listen to and turn towards. Scott said something last week that was really important. He said that as we read through the Proverbs, we see all these different sayings and principles, and they're only rightly and fully understood when we read them through the lens of the rest of the Bible. That's true here in Proverbs chapter 9 as well. And the rest of the Bible, the New Testament very specifically, reveals to us the true personification of wisdom. Wisdom is a person, and the person is Jesus Christ. One of those New Testament passages that I'm talking about was read to us just a little bit earlier in the service in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I'm going to put it back on the screen for you. Look at it. Paul says there, we preach Christ crucified. It's a stumbling block to Jews, folly to the Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. Christ is the wisdom of God. In Colossians chapter 2, Paul writes that it's his desire for Christians to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. The Bible is very clear. Jesus Christ is the fountain of all wisdom. So when we read Proverbs 9 here and we're hearing the voice of wisdom, we're hearing the voice of the Lord. Look at verse 10 here in Proverbs chapter 9. This has been the sort of the signature verse of this entire series. This is where we see it so clearly. It's the fear of the Lord that is the beginning of wisdom. It's knowledge of the Holy One that is insight. So here's the point. Before we can confidently hope to make any wise decisions in life, I'm going to say that again. Before you can confidently hope to make any wise decisions in life, we have to deal seriously with the most important decision of all. The source of all wisdom is calling out to us. Wisdom's messengers have been sent out from the high places, right? We just read that in Proverbs 9. And that's exactly what the Lord has done. He has sent out his messengers from the high places. He has sent out the prophets to speak to us the words of wisdom. He has sent out the apostles to speak to us the words of wisdom. He continues to send his messengers today. Even as I stand here and I'm preaching to you now, it is not really my voice that you're hearing. It is the voice of the Lord as we open up his word. He is speaking to us. The invitation to turn and to enter in is right now within earshot of every one of us. And anyone can enter. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. The Lord is telling us the table is set before you. Life is being offered to you. Jesus said, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly, right? It is the feast. It's the steakhouse dinner. He's setting it out before us. And unless we respond to him, unless we hear him and turn and enter in, we can never hope to escape the entrapment of Lady Folly and the ultimate destination of all who follow her, the very depths of Sheol. Now listen, that doesn't mean that apart from Christ, you're entirely incapable of ever making a good decision. That's not how the Bible speaks of our total corruption with sin. You can still make some good decisions because you still bear the image of God and you're still existing within his common grace. But the Bible is very clear about this. Even your best decisions, apart from Christ, even the smartest things you do, even the best deeds that you perform are like filthy rags before him when they're done in your own strength. And the reason for that is because your soul is still bound up by your inherent sinfulness. This is how Ephesians 2 describes the condition of the person whose soul is still bound up in their sinfulness. You are dead in the trespasses and sins in which you walk, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. The prince of the power of the air is the devil. It's Satan himself, the very spirit of Lady Folly. Is that you? Is that you this morning? Wisdom's calling. So how do you respond? How do you respond to Jesus and you find life and wisdom? Here's how you do that. Firstly, you need to admit that you need him. I love how when Travis came up here a few minutes ago and he led us in that prayer of confession, he read from that parable where Jesus talks about the Pharisee and the tax collector, right? The Pharisee comes up, Lord, I'm so glad I'm not like all those sinners out there. But the tax collector, who was at the bottom of the barrel in society, right? Nobody liked the tax collector. Tax collectors were known to be sinful people, and the tax collector says, I'm the worst sinner I know. God, forgive me. That's the response. Admit you need him. Confess your sin to him. And then recognize. Recognize that he died on the cross to pay the penalty for your sin so that you could be forgiven. Trust him by faith to be your Savior. Give your life to him. Give your life to him. Enter in and recline at his table. He is inviting you to come. Wisdom is calling. Don't be a scoffer. That's what Solomon's actually going to warn his son about next. Don't be a scoffer. Let's look at the difference between the wise person and the scoffer. Verse 7. Whoever corrects a scoffer gets himself abuse, and he who reproves a wicked man incurs injury. Do not reprove a scoffer, or he will hate you. All right, look up for a second. What's a scoffer? What is a scoffer? Well, Proverbs actually tells us what a scoffer is. In Proverbs chapter 21, verse 24, it says this, scoffer is the name of the arrogant, haughty man who acts with arrogant pride. So what Solomon is saying here in chapter 9 is you can't reprove or rebuke a guy like that, right? He'll hate you for it because his pride is so prideful, he's so puffed up with himself, he's not going to hear any correction. He's got it all figured out. He doesn't need anybody or anything, least of which is the Lord. That's a scoffer. Psalm 74, verses 22 and 23. Arise, O God, defend your cause. Remember how the foolish scoff at you all the day, right? That's the heart of a scoffer. It's not just that they're scoffing at things in general. Ultimately, they're scoffing at God. And so the psalmist prays, don't forget the clamor of your foes, the uproars of those who rise against you, which goes up continually. That's the scoffer. And what is the fate of the scoffer? Proverbs 19, it's very clear. Proverbs 19, verse 29, condemnation is ready for scoffers and beating for the backs of fools. To scoff, again, is ultimately to say, Lord, I don't need you. And the fate of the scoffer is condemnation, hard-heartedness, eternal punishment. Acts chapter 13, verse 41, look, you scoffers, be astounded and perish. For I am doing a work in your days, a work that you will not believe, even if one tells it to you. That's a scary and sobering statement. Saying even if you hear what God is doing, even if the Lord were to show you all that he is and is set before you, you're so hard-hearted in your scoffing that you wouldn't hear it. You wouldn't see it. Solomon is telling his son and us, don't be that guy. In contrast, verse 8, second part of verse 8, reprove a wise man and he will love you. Why? Because he's humble. He's humble enough to know, I need this. Give instruction to a wise man and he will be still wiser. Teach a righteous man, and he will increase in learning. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is insight. For by me, the Lord says, your days will be multiplied, and years will be added to your life. I've titled the message here this morning, Wise Decisions. That is the most important decision any of us can ever make. Wisdom is calling. Folly is too. And folly has an advantage. We already live in that house. But wisdom is calling. Turn in here. Come to me. Have life. Walk in the way of insight. What do we do then? What does life look like as we walk in the way of insight? That's the last thing we're going to look at this morning. For all who respond to the voice of the Lord, here's the good news. He grants you a new heart. He gives you a renewed mind. And he gives us a new status. Remember our old status we read in Ephesians chapter 2. You're dead in your trespasses and sin. In the gospel, God addresses us in a new way. He calls us his children. Notice how throughout the Proverbs, Solomon is instructing his son, right? We keep reading that over and over again. My son, hear me. My son, my son, my son. This is what God's word is telling to those of us who belong to him in Christ. Your sons, your daughters. Hebrews 12:7 says to all Christians that God is treating you as sons. Ephesians 1, verse 5 says that in love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. God sees you in a whole new way. when you turn to Christ in wisdom. And so, we need to see ourselves in that same new way as God sees us. So can I encourage you this morning, those of you who have turned to Christ and trusted in him, listen to the words of William Romaine. He was an Anglican preacher who lived back in the 18th century. This was during the years of the Great Awakening in England and the United States. And this is what he says to Christians. He says, consider your state. Consider who you are. You are a pardoned sinner. You're not under the law. You're under grace, freely, fully saved from the guilt of all your sins. There is no one to condemn, God having justified you. He sees you in his Son, washed you in his blood. He has clothed you in his righteousness, and he embraces him and you, the head and the members, with the same affection. Amen? That's what it means to be in Christ. And therefore, we're told in Ephesians 5, verse 1, therefore, be imitators of God as his beloved children. Walk in the wisdom that God gives. Follow after what he says. And in Christ, he's given us the help to do that. He's given us his Holy Spirit to indwell us and to lead us in all wisdom. Romans 8, 12 to 14. So then, brothers, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. John 14, 26, Jesus says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. So in Christ, we have a whole new way to live. And we have a whole new power in which to live that new way. We have the Holy Spirit in us. We have the help of God, of wisdom himself. So how does that new life in Christ and the Holy Spirit within you then prepare you for now walking in the ways of insight? How do you make wise decisions in life? Here's the application. This is what a lot of you have been waiting for. How do we make wise decisions? You need Christ. But in Christ, the Holy Spirit has given us tools for making wise choices. Here's the first tool he's given you, his word. His word. Write down Psalm 1, verses 1 and 2. It says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. So you're now in Christ, and you're walking down that straight path, and decisions come. You meet crossroads at different points, and you go, what should I do? What decision should I make here? Here's the first thing you should be asking yourself. Does God's word have anything specific to say about this? Are there explicit or implicit commands in Scripture that would help me know how to make this choice wisely? And there's lots of things that will have very explicit or very clearly implicit commands that will help you. I've been thinking about dating this girl. She's not a believer, but I really like her. I don't know, is it okay if I, should I date her anyway? Well, God's word's pretty clear. We're not to be unequally yoked together with non-believers, right? Yeah, there you go, right? My fiance and I are about to get married. We don't really have the money to pull off the wedding right now. It's going to take another year and a half or so for us to be able to have that ceremony. But in the meantime, I mean, we're already engaged. I think we're just going to move in together. Does God, in his word, have anything to say about living together, sleeping together, outside of the covenant of marriage? Of course he does, right? There's lots of things that we can look at in Scripture where there's an explicit or implicit command. Are you going to the Word of God through the help of the Spirit of God when you are thinking about major decisions you're making in life? If you don't start there, you've started off on the wrong foot. God's given us His Word. The second tool that the Holy Spirit has given us for making wise choices is His convicting work. He convicts us. He speaks to us. He impresses upon us. John chapter 16, verse 8, when He comes, the Holy Spirit, He will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. The Holy Spirit's job is to convict us, to lead us. That's both negative sometimes, don't do that. Sometimes it's positive. Yes, do that, right? But that's what He does. Do I have any hesitations? Ask that question when you're faced with a big decision. Do I have any hesitations in this? Why? Is the Holy Spirit trying to tell me, pull back? Sometimes we have hesitations because we're afraid and the Holy Spirit's trying to say, go, right? But am I listening to Him? You say, how do I know if I'm discerning the Holy Spirit and listening well to what He says? Well, you know, Galatians 5 is pretty helpful here. Galatians 5 tells us what the works of the flesh look like versus the fruit of the Spirit. Go there. As I'm contemplating this major decision in my life, look at, is this gonna help me to exhibit the fruit of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control? Will those things be present and be able to flourish in my life based on this decision that I'm going to make? Will this decision help me to love God and help me to love others, the great commandments as God has called me to do? Or will this decision maybe lead me more towards a greater increase of my fleshliness? Jealousy, anger, rivalry, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, things like these, right? Like what fruit is going to be produced in my life depending on the decision that I make? The Holy Spirit gives us tools. He convicts us. Listen to Him. Thirdly, a tool that the Holy Spirit gives us is His help in prayer. Romans 8, 27, the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We're called to pray without ceasing, right? To pray at all times. We're called to let our requests be made known to God. And we're also told here, the Spirit prays along with us. He helps us to pray. So when you're making a decision, you come to a crossroads, here's a great question to ask. Have I prayed about this? Have I prayed about this? Am I saying, Lord, I want the voice of wisdom. I want Your voice to inform me here. Ask Him. Here's another tool He's given to us, His church. Ephesians 4. Paul there talks about the whole purpose of the church body. He says that we're for building up the body of Christ, all of us, until we attain the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. If that's true, if the church is here to help us to grow in maturity, then what a great thing to do when you're trying to make a big decision in life. And I don't know what to do. Have you sought the godly counsel of others within the body of Christ? He's telling us clearly here that He's given us one another for that purpose. That's one I wish people would utilize more. Really, truly. I mean, I think we really undervalue the blessing of the body of Christ and the ministry that we have in each other's lives when we're making big decisions. I just mentioned a couple earlier, like who should I marry? Here's a great thing. Why don't you seek some godly counsel on that? What job should I take? I have this opportunity. I have that opportunity. I'm not really sure. Seek godly counsel. We're thinking of moving. moving to a different city, moving to a different state? Have you sought counsel about that? God has given us his church. And finally, the last tool I want to present to you this morning that he's given to you is his freedom. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Galatians 5, 13. For you were called to freedom, brothers. Only don't use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. Here's I think, a really helpful and important tool when you're faced with decisions. You've got the Holy Spirit in you, believer. You are a child of God. You are free in him. And there will be many, many times when you'll be faced with a decision that there's not a clear, explicit, or implicit command in Scripture. There'll be times when you can pray about it, and sort of either one seems like a valid, legitimate decision that you can make. And here's what I see happen a lot, is people get to that point where they're like, I'm not getting clarity in the Word, I'm not getting clarity in prayer, I've sought godly counsel from others, and I'm getting it from both sides, I don't know what to do, and then they get stuck. And they're waiting for a lightning bolt from heaven. And until they get the lightning bolt, they're not going to move. God hasn't called you to that. Boy, a lot of you get stuck because you're sitting in that position. Here's the beautiful news in Christ. By his Spirit, you have freedom. You could pick either option and still be within the will of God. How about that? How wonderful. The only question you need to ask when it relates to your freedom is, would my freedom in this situation lead me to works of the flesh, selfish gain, or godliness, loving him, serving others, right? If there's a tension there, you know which way to go. Another thing you need to be aware of is if your freedoms would be a stumbling block to others, you need to give deference to others, right? We have some instruction in Scripture about how to use our freedoms, but we have freedom. And again, the beauty of that freedom is that it is only found because of your position in Christ. Apart from Christ, you don't have that freedom. You still have free will, but again, every decision you make is bound by your sinfulness. In Christ, you're really free. You're really free to live and glorify God. 2 Peter 1:3 says, his divine power, God's divine power, has granted to us, Christians, all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. So I'll close with this quote. It's from Dane Ortlund. I think this is really helpful. He's thinking about how we live. How do we walk in the way of insight? How do we make decisions in life? He says, it's the love of God that creates your wise choice moment by moment. His love creates your wise choice moment by moment. Look to him by faith. See his love for you right now and receive it. Then, whatever might be your next step of obedience, that bold new step that maybe you've been putting off, you will take it. You will be able to choose wisely to the praise of his glory and his grace. I didn't read the last part there of that middle section, verse 12 of Proverbs 9, but Solomon says this to his son. He says, if you're wise, you're wise for yourself. In other words, if you're wise, it's to your benefit. But if you scoff, you alone will bear it. Wisdom's calling. Choose wisely. Let me pray. Father, thank you for your word. And Lord, I don't want to move us too far down the application scale here without stopping again and just pausing on that most important decision that we'll ever make. Lord, if there's anyone in this room who is walking in the way of folly because they've scoffed at the way of wisdom, Lord, I pray that you, even this morning, have just been chiseling away at the hardness of their heart, that they would hear the voice of the Lord, the voice of wisdom, the voice of salvation that calls to give new life, abundant life, and insight. Lord, help that person or those persons in this room right now to hear your voice and to respond to you by faith. And I pray, Lord, for all of us that we would continue to respond to you by faith, by trust and obedience, that we would hear the voice of wisdom. Even in Christ, the voice of folly will call after us. But Lord, we can turn. We're free. So help us to walk in that freedom. Help us to let your spirit be the one who leads us in our thinking and our decisions. May your word direct us. May the conviction of the spirit direct us. May the counsel of others in the body of Christ correct us. May our prayer lives direct us. So again, that we would live free in you, glorifying you with our lives and the decisions that we make. Help us, Father. Help us and satisfy us as we walk in the way of insight and feast at the table of your goodness. You are good. And we pray all that in Jesus' name. Amen.